We'll bring Mitch Lawrence into the conversation. Forbes, Sporting News, Sirius XM, NBA Radio. We know, Mitch, there's a collision course that's going to happen, right? There's not going to be an upset. We're not going to get the story. The NBA doesn't want that story. They want the mega powers colliding here. Is it good? I mean, is this a compelling playoff? Is this good for basketball?
Absolutely. It's great. I'm glad you mentioned the Lakers and the Celtics. They met three times in the 80s in a four-year span. I don't remember anybody ever complaining about that when Magic Johnson and Larry Bird went head-to-head. And it was, I remember the league back then because I was covering it, and there was always kind of a letdown when one of those two teams didn't make it. I remember the Rockets made it one year, and it was like, oh, my God, you know, the Rockets are in. Why don't they, you know, they beat Magic and all. And, you know, hey, I think it's just great because, first of all, you know, as you know, there has never been a series – where the finals entrants have met three straight years. This would be a first. So that's always great. It would be the rubber match, since obviously Golden State won in 15 and the Cavs won last year in a remarkable, you know, historic comeback, being down 3-1. And you got the best players in the sport. I mean, how can you not like LeBron, who's playing like he's 28 years old, going up against the two-time reigning MVP, and you throw in Kevin Durant for good measure. And I'm talking about, obviously, Steph Curry. You throw in Kevin Durant for good measure. I mean, come on. This is a great thing.
Mitch, you talk about those Lakers and Celtics final matchups. So was the path then, though, to get there more compelling?
Who remembers? Right? I mean, look, all I remember
That's
is...
That's a good point.
Not because of Twitter, because of social media, and because of the TV, the saturation. Do you ever remember watching first-round games back in the 80s?
It's a great point.
The league didn't start to like, the playoffs didn't start to like the conference finals. So it was a whole different world. Now everything is under the microscope. And that is really what's killing the regular season. The regular season used to be an enormous, big deal, and you never really looked ahead to the finals. I don't remember sitting there going, I can't wait for the Celtics and the Lakers, because the regular season really meant something. And now it's like the luster is off, or it just doesn't mean as much. And I think it's because there's games all the time on TV, and we see all these teams' flaws, and you know, we basically see it's got to be these two teams who are head and shoulders above everybody else.
It's funny you mention that, Mitch, and we'll get into the NBA playoffs. Mitch Lawrence, longtime NBA columnist, now a host on Sirius XM NBA Radio. He writes for the Sporting News, which is a lot of the topic we've been having today. Also Forbes, which is the way that we consume sports and the way that it's covered differently. I mean, you covered the NBA and newspaper stuff, and now, you know, Sporting News used to be a magazine that you picked up all the time. I mean, call on the fly, man. You got your Sporting News, and that was it. Now it's just a website stuff. But how covering the NBA, the consumption of the NBA product is so different?
Well, I mean, first of all, it used to be just, you know, going to a playoff series, it was only newspaper guys. You had TV people and radio people. You didn't have anything called the Internet. And the access to players was much different. I was thinking about this the other day. I remember the Bulls went into, they got a split. This is with Jordan back in the 90s. I can't remember exactly what year. I'm tempted to say it's the second three-peat, but it was definitely not 1996, where, you know, the Bulls ran roughshod over everybody until they got to the finals. So it was probably the next year, 97, 98. And I think they got a split with Atlanta. And we went into Memorial Day weekend. They actually played a back-to-back, if my memory serves. We go into the Omni. I remember going up to Jordan with like two or three other writers and just sitting there before a game BSing with him. Like, that doesn't happen anymore. You just don't walk up to LeBron James. Even if he's in the – first of all, you don't even know if he'll be in the locker room. He may be, but it's a whole different thing. Now there's a – you walk into a locker room, you go, who the heck are these other people here? I call them space eaters because they take up a lot of room. But, I mean, it's just a different world. It's a different – people are consuming things differently on their phones and everything. So this is what it is now, and it's great, right?
Sure, right. Yeah, we love it.
I remember one, by the way, Mitch. May 1990, the Sixers beat the Cleveland Cavaliers in the first round of the Eastern Conference playoffs. I remember it. They won 3-2. I remember it, A, because the genie box just told me when I looked it up. But I also remember it because my brother and I sat behind the Cleveland bench yelling, E-blow, yeah, over and over to Craig Elo.
Well, I want to tell you something, guys. You know, there was a big date in NBA history a couple of days ago. We talked about it on Sirius. You know, the Jordan shot over Craig Elo, right? And people just remember it as the shot. But you got to remember, too, that's the first time Michael ever got out of the first round. He had been 1-9 in his first 10 playoff games with three straight series losses to open up his postseason career. So why is he going nuts and celebrating after he makes a shot against Craig Ehlo? He finally gets out of the first round because we were all sitting there, and there were a lot of people in the league sitting there going, you know what, this guy's a prolific scorer, but can he ever win big? And that's, you know, that puts it in perspective for people. That's why Michael Jordan, that was such a big deal back, I think it was May 7th, 1989.
Get a little note here from my producer that says Michael Jordan defeated 39 Basketball Hall of Famers on his way to 6 NBA championships. That fits right in with what we're talking about, Mitch.
Well, you know, for a lot of us, Michael Jordan is still the best. And nothing against LeBron, because LeBron, what he's doing now is phenomenal. But, you know, you're talking about a guy who's a 6'6", 215-pound wing player, you know, scorer, versus a guy who's 6'8", 250, 260, who can do a lot more than Michael Jordan ever do, but he can't. The big difference to me, a couple is, as a scorer, as a late-game closeout guy, nobody was better than Michael with the ball in his hands, not even LeBron. And then the other thing was, Michael never had these moments where we saw, and this is now a long time ago for LeBron, don't get me wrong, LeBron last year, I mean, he sent out a lot of ghosts, a lot of skeletons in his closet. He eliminated with the whole comeback against Golden State. If you remember the series, though, the finals against Dallas, where he and the Miami Heat are up 2-1, and then he imploded in those fourth quarters, three or four games in a row, Michael never had a moment like that in the finals. And that's what differentiates them. Also, when LeBron first go around in Cleveland in 2010, and they went out meekly against Boston, he was basically like giving up on the court. Michael Jordan never had a moment like that in the playoffs. To me, those are the biggest differences between LeBron, who I love, and Michael, who I, you know, put on the big pedestal.
Yeah, and you know, the interesting part about this is we're watching this edition of the NBA playoffs, kind of knowing what the outcome will be, at least through the conference portion of them. We're seeing the shift here, aren't we, Mitch? I mean, LeBron was the villain. He was the guy that everybody nitpicked on. And it seemingly is that people are, okay, I give in. This guy's great. I admit it. And Durant has kind of faded into, I don't know what his role is. I don't know who, like, is he the villain? Is he like, yeah. Well, I mean, Durant was the likable guy in Oklahoma City. Now I don't know who he is anymore.
Well, two things. One, I think a lot of people got behind LeBron or really started to embrace LeBron more when he went back home to Cleveland and he fulfilled the promise of, I want to get this town, which didn't have a championship since the 64 Browns, I want to lead them to a title. I think a lot of people loved that. And he did it with guys like Irving and Love, who had never won. You know, he went to Miami. Now, Chris Bosh had problems getting out of the first round, but Dwayne Wade was the finals MVP. A lot of people didn't like that from the get-go. Now, as for Kevin Durant, he's still public enemy number one in a few cities, including Oklahoma City. But that's a kind of a likable team. I mean, the one thing about the Currys and Steph Curry, who carries himself very well, you know, there's nobody who doesn't really like Steph Curry, I don't think. Kids love him. They can relate to him. He's kind of on the small side. He carries himself well on and off the court. He's an unbelievable. I mean, the stuff he does on the court with his range is crazy. But the thing about Kevin Durant on the court that is so impressive now is that he's basically Golden State's best player. If you saw Game 3 the other night against Utah, when they needed somebody to really step forward and give them a dominant performance because Curry really didn't have it going for a while, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green, they rode Kevin Durant's back. And the great thing about Curry was, when asked about deferring, he goes, hey, I was just doing what 19,000 people in this arena and all the people on TV saw is that this guy had it going, and Durant was spectacular. Especially, you know, Utah had it a 7-point game, you know, what was it, early, or, you know, fourth quarter, late third, early fourth, and here came Durant and Curry too, but it was really Durant. And so he gave you his signature moment as a Warrior. Is he going to be painted as the villain here? Could be. It's him more than LeBron because, you know what, they are still the super team. And a lot of people don't like the fact that he left Oklahoma City and really crippled them in terms of being a championship contender, right? They're just now a good team that can make the playoffs. Before, they were minutes away from going to the finals last year, if you remember, before he and Russell Westbrook blew Game 6. So I think more people will be behind LeBron and against the Warriors.
Mitch Lawrence, longtime NBA columnist, Sirius XM NBA Radio, Sporting News, and Forbes. His piece at Forbes right now is talking about these Warriors who are missing the coach. I mean, think about that. Yeah. We talk about Phil Jackson and the role that how great he was with them, and Popovich,
Pat Riley, the coach
matters, and they're doing this without their coach.
It's amazing, and I've known Steve Kerr since he's a player. It's a great guy. It's really sad to see this because if you know anything about Steve Kerr, he wants to be there, and he can't because this botched back surgery, which has now resulted in him having these huge migraine problems and headaches, and last week he finally had another procedure done at Duke to try to fix this problem, which he's been had. You know, he blew out a disc in his back in Game 5 of the 2015 Finals. He had surgery sometime thereafter, in the next month or so, and it's been problematic ever since, although not really, you know, he's able to survive for a while, but lately it got to be problematic. He's now missed 6 games. They're 6-0. The key thing here was that you got to credit the Warriors. You know, ownership and Bob Myers, the GM, saw, you know what, maybe Steve Kerr this year may not be able to answer the bell for some of these games. So when Luke Walton, who was their top assistant, went to the Lakers, remember after last year's finals, they had a chance to bring in a bunch of, you know, top flight assistants, one guy, or maybe bring in a guy with head coaching experience. And because of Kerr's situation, that kind of tenuous deal with the back, they made a bold move and a great move bringing in Mike Brown. Now, Mike Brown has coached LeBron. That's why the finals will be so interesting, because he was always subservient to LeBron when he was at Cleveland. He also coached Kobe Bryant, had problems with Kobe. But with these guys like Curry and Draymond Green so far and Kevin Durant, he's pushing all the right buttons. Plus, these guys, you know, inherited a team that you have to remember, last year for them was a total bust. Yeah, they broke the Bulls' record, 73 wins. Yeah, that was a great accomplishment. But when they blew that series with a 3-1 lead against Cleveland and lost the finals to them, like Klay Thompson said, he called it a complete bust. So he's taken over a team that really wants to run the table and be the first team to ever go 16-0 in a playoff run. They're halfway there. I don't know if they can do it necessarily, but when he's talking to players and they know the situation, these guys are smart. They know what's going on with Steve Kerr and how Steve Kerr should be there and can't. Now Mike Brown's filling in. It's not like a bunch of kids in high school who are messing around with the substitute teacher. These guys are all business, and they're different type of superstars than LeBron and Kobe.
It's a great article. Check it out, Forbes.com. Mitch_Lawrence. Really compelling about, you know, can imagine the Bulls without Jackson, the Lakers teams without Jackson, Riley not there. Just see how those teams, how you would view, I mean, we view the Spurs the way we view the Spurs because of Popovich, right? I mean, the coach is the personality.
Can you even name me a Spurs assistant?
Yeah, Brett Brown.
The girl.
Brett Brown. Mike Budenholzer. They're all gone.
Who's the girl? Becky Hammond? Yeah, there's Ator Messina, and there's Ipke Udoka. But really, it's all Popovich, right?
Right.
That's what we see. And he does have a great support staff. But, yeah, he is a, you know, he's a star. He's a superstar coach. I mean, he's won 5 titles. So, yeah, you look at that, and you're like, hey, Steve Kerr has won a title. Steve Kerr was basically, what, you know, they're up 3-1. He could have 2 titles right now. He probably should, if not for Draymond Green going crazy in Game 5 with retaliating. So, yeah, it's a huge story. It's a big deal. And we'll see if it comes back to bite. You know, we'll see, first of all.
Yeah.
Nobody knows if Steve's going to be back for the duration. He may not be. And then what happens when Mike Brown goes up against LeBron James? Because you're already hearing all these theories out there about, well, LeBron knows Mike Brown better than anybody. He'll know all his moves. He'll be able to counter all his moves. Silly me, I thought Ty Lue was the coach.
So let me get your opinion on this then, because you might not have Kerr. There's Curry, Clay, and Green. When LeBron won in Miami, it was Dwayne Wade's team, even though LeBron was very instrumental.
Oh, yeah.
Will Durant, do people view it the same? Well, this is Curry's team, or this is their team. Or is it Durant was the finishing piece? It's a little different. That team was already together. Durant came in.
Yeah,
that team got put together all at once.
They won. I mean, the difference is obviously. Now, Wade had won in Miami with a different cast and Shaq, right? And then he didn't win, and then they brought LeBron in to be with Chris Bosh. So they were going off on a, you know, playoff journey to see if they can win a title. Kevin Durant goes in there. We all saying he's taking the easy way out. They've already won. You know, I mean, these guys don't have, they won without Kevin Durant. Why do they need Kevin Durant? Well, they need Kevin Durant because late in playoff games, their track record is when their long shots aren't falling and they don't get to the foul line. They don't get to the foul line. They don't score. They don't stop the other teams from their runouts. Kevin Durant will get them big free throw, big possessions, whether it's shots or free throws, which is always great to stop the momentum of the other team because he can do that historically in the playoffs. He goes to the line a lot more times in these games than Steph Curry.
Right.
So it's really Curry's team. And Durant is more, you know, he's along for the ride, but obviously his role is bigger than that.
All right, we got two compelling series left. Mitch Lawrence with us. Tonight, we got 2-2 San Antonio-Houston. What say you for the last, the three-game series we got left here? What say you?
Well, you know, the two games Houston's won, they shot tremendous threes, and their small ball attack has won. The two games that San Antonio's won, their defense, their ability to play big to basically smother the smaller Rockets has held sway. I don't have a real great feel being in northern New Jersey as to how these teams are. Nene's loss for the Rockets hurts because he's one of their few bigs who's effective. Patrick Beverley coming back from his grandfather's funeral in Chicago. He's supposed to make the game tonight. He had a big impact on the game the other night. Let's see what James Harden does. Here's the key number for me, guys. When James Harden goes off and scores like 40 points and has 5 assists, they usually lose. He's got to have 10, 11, 12 assists like you saw the last game. I think he had 12 assists. He's got to be getting the ball to people, and guys are making shots. I think Eric Gordon's going to start tonight. The Rockets are really small. I picked the Spurs in this series. I didn't like it when Tony Parker went down. I thought they might be able to survive. I still think it's their series.
All right. The other one, of course, we've talked many times about Washington's inability to win on the road. They got a three-game series left. They're going to have to figure out a way to win one of these games on the road. Can Washington do it?
I think they can. I don't have a lot of confidence in them. I don't have a lot of confidence in Boston. I mean, Isaiah Thomas gave you his signature moment, one of the great epic playoff performances we've seen, especially for an undersized guy, giving you 53 points. And since then, he's been lost. You know, he had 13 points the next game. Then the next game, all he's doing is complaining about not going to the foul line. I don't know where his focus in his head is. I think I picked Washington to win this series in upset. I still think they can. I just don't have a lot of faith in them, but I got even less faith in Boston.
All right, Mitch Lawrence, before we let you run here, we saw yesterday Kyle Lowry opt out, and the rumors are rampant. Brian Colangelo, Villanova,
that's
Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Are you connecting the same dots, or is that the right move for the Sixers, right?
Well, Kyle Lowry also said he wanted to win a ring. So I don't know where Philadelphia stacks up in that, right? I mean, they're a building team. Sure, they'd love to have him as a veteran leader, a guy who could play the point alongside Ben Simmons. Although I think they want Ben Simmons with the ball in his hands.
Yeah.
I think he's at his stage of his career, guys, where he can't mess around with going like to Philadelphia to kind of babysit and to be with a young rising team. If he really wants to chase a ring, he's got to hope maybe the Spurs want him. I mean, the Spurs are going to have a big question of point guard. What are they going to do about that? Because Tony Parker now has an injury that basically forced Barkley and Mutombo to retire,
Blowing
out that quad tendon. So if you're Kyle Lowry, maybe you want the Spurs to call. Or is Toronto going to ante up and give him a ton of money? Their team president, Masai Ujiri, had a big press conference today, and he basically put everybody on notice. I wouldn't be surprised if they fired Dwayne Casey. Doesn't sound like he's too secure. I wouldn't be surprised if they waved goodbye to Kyle Lowry. Masai Ujiri, the team president, said, we need a culture change here.
Wow.
Uh-oh.
That's not a ringing endorsement for
Ink
anybody.
Slips are coming.
You know what, guys? That's what happens when you play LeBron James in the playoffs. He forces you to have a culture change.
Well, you know what? We'll see LeBron James plenty more in the playoffs, and maybe straight through, no losses so far. It's the only time it's happened since the Pistons and the Lakers. They both made it all the way through unbeaten in 1989. I was 12.
And I was there, and it was a terrible. That's the series where Magic blew out his hamstring. I think it was Game 2, and Byron Scott also had a leg injury. And what we thought was going to be this epic series, because we had two undefeated teams through the playoffs, turned into an easy four-game sweep for the Pistons, the first of their little two-peat they had.
He was 12. I was 18. Mitch Lawrence was working.
There you go. And having a good time out in Auburn Hills.
I bet. Those bad boy teeth were great. Mitch Lawrence, Sirius XM NBA Radio, Forbes, and, of course, Sporting News. Check him out, Mitch_Lawrence, as the NBA playoffs continue to what we all believe will be a Golden State-Cleveland three-peat, the trilogy. It will be like boxing. You got to have three to figure it all out, and that's exactly what we'll probably get. Mitch, we'll be talking, pal.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.